We're on Six Nations, about to pay a visit with Chef Tawnya Brant. Now, she's the very proud owner of this restaurant called Yawego, which is a Mohawk word for delicious. So let's head on in and see what she's been cooking. So here we are in the kitchen with Chef Tawnya Brant at Yawego, and this is where the magic happens. So you opened the restaurant in November?
Yes.
And that was in the midst of COVID. So
yeah.
The restaurant business is always a challenging business on its own. Add COVID to the mix, how did you manage to survive and create such a big business here? It seems to be doing well. I've been standing outside for a while watching so many clients come in and go.
Well, that's what some people are like, well, what is it like being open during COVID? And I'm like, well, I don't know what it's like to be not open during COVID. So I'm hoping it'll get even better than it is, because it's been going pretty great for us so far. People want to try something new. We get a lot of like tourism if they want to try local flavors. And we're kind of like this, a little gem right now, right? Like, I didn't spend big on advertising and things like that. I didn't want to be overwhelmed. I want to make sure I had enough, but I wanted what it was that we are going to put out to just be amazing, to represent us, to represent me as a chef, and this is my cuisine and what I do. Every cuisine in the world you can try. There's good Italian, there's bad Italian, there's good Greek, there's bad Greek. You can't say that about Indigenous foods, because people don't have a cause for comparison. We do add things from all over Turtle Island, but in the end, it's their take on food. I'm helping revive Haudenosaunee cuisine.
And how has your food been received by the locals here on Six Nations?
I think it took a minute for people to be like, okay, what's the concept here? Like, what are we doing? Like, this used to be, it was just like concession stand food, burgers and fries. And so we still get those people come in. That place was here for 30 years. And now that people, like local people, are used to it, they're kind of like, I don't really know what I'm going to have today. So and when they come here now, they're just like, you know what? I don't even want it. I'm just going to come here and find out what it is. So a lot of our food comes from Mohawk Seed Keeper's Garden, which is my mother's garden that she has. And she grows all Haudenosaunee varieties of like corn, beans, and squash. We have about 11 varieties of heirloom tomatoes that we're growing right now. And then I also work with local just hunters for like game meat. We get like moose, elk, venison, pickerel. So we got a lot of things that are going on, but I like it because it's supporting people in what they're doing. Right? Like, if it's springtime, you plant stuff. If it's, you know, it's winter time, we're tapping trees. I'm not just setting out to feed people. I want them to go home. I want them to try it. I want to demystify Indigenous foods for people.
You'd ask me to tell you the name of a dish that would be one of my favorites from one of the restaurants, which I did. I told you that I love beef bourguignon, especially in the fall time. I like to eat it with a little polenta. I understand you have indigenized your own version of a bourguignon dish.
I did, and it was a bit of a challenge. I will say that. I did look at it, and beef bourguignon, one of the things you're going to notice is, like, it's a whole bunch of wine and a whole bunch of port. So in most Indigenous communities, because of past traumas and things like that, alcohol's not something that many people... If I served alcohol in here, I probably would have nobody in here, which is super interesting, right?
That is.
So when I decided that when I wanted to indigenize that recipe, I didn't want to use alcohol. But how do you do that without, how do you do that in a dish that's all
interesting
alcohol?
Interesting dilemma,
right?
Yes.
So what we did was we foraged and we got a whole bunch of wild grapes. So our wild grapes that grow here are an ancestor to Concord grapes. So Concord grapes are the only Indigenous variety that are commercially grown today. So we took a whole bunch of those and I made a juice concentrate out of it that we didn't sweeten or anything, because I wanted those tannins and that same like stuff you're going to get from wine, those tastes.
Well, why don't we start plating it?
And yeah.
as we see the dish, we can bring it to life by saying what's in it. Wonderful.
So our water's boiling. What I have here is just a Haudenosaunee blue corn.
So it cooks like a polenta in a boiling water or a chicken stock or something like that?
Yep. Exact same way there.
Is this what you call mush?
Yes, so like, yeah, I guess in Italian you would say polenta, we just say corn mush.
So that's the corn mush to go with the mousse bourguignon. And we've got a pan here of...
Yeah, so we got some toppings here, what we got here for today. So we had some foraging done for you. We do have some small piece of puffball mushroom These are a horse mushroom and milkweed pods. So that's what we're going to use to plate. And we're also going to use, this is wild boar bacon that we're using for it as well.
Lovely.
And let's get that out and we can see how the
bourguignon's doing. And the milkweed pods are pickled?
Yes, they're pickled.
Very nice.
If you want to mix that around a little, there's still some jus in there.
Yes. Like most meat, game meat, it's very, very lean. Obviously, moose is a huge animal. Yeah. And this looks like it's from the leg, so it's a portion of the leg meat, which, exactly, which needs a good, long, slow cooking.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's plate up a portion and we'll try some.
I think we'll put the polenta on the bottom and this on top.
Sounds like a great idea.
Yeah.
Okay. Perfect.
Like, I mean, I seen you eyeing that marrow. I'm wondering, do I give you?
There is no pulling the wool over your eyes. And then we have the fresh sautéed mushrooms and foraged ingredients.
We just got these like yesterday.
Lovely stuff. And the wild boar crispy bacon.
Yep.
Look at that. This looks terrific. It really does.
Like for me, at my house growing up, it was a lot of game meat and things like that. Elk was number one, moose was number two, venison sat in the freezer. Should we do some studio? Say, I don't know. I want to try the bulbs. Actually, the ramp bulbs is what I really want to.
Look at that. Tawnya, this is delicious. You have created a moose bourguignon indigenized.
Mm-hmm.
The flavor really is absolutely magnificent. It really, really is. It definitely has that gamier tone to it, but without it being overpowering.
Yeah.
The balance of the flavors is spot on, and the meat is so moist and tender.
Mm-hmm.
And the corn mush for the, 2.5 minutes it took to cook is really beautiful and creamy. And you did nothing but water and salt.
Yep.
That is a great
You don't really miss the wine.
I don't miss the wine.
Because it's something different on its own, really.
Exactly. And it goes to show how food, cuisines can blend together and become harmonized, taking inspiration from a classic French dish, taking a little bit of inspiration from your cooking roots and producing a dish that I am sure will sell like hotcakes at this restaurant. Well done.
Sego Sewa Guego, I'm Chef Tawnya Brant, the owner and chef of Yawego Foods right here. We're located on Six Nations of the Grand River Territory. We're open Monday to Friday, 9 to 5. We're open for lunch. You can check it out. I have Facebook and Instagram under Chef Tawnya Brant, also under Yawego. And I also have a YouTube channel if you're interested in learning how to cook some of this stuff, and a website as well. There's some recipes on there.
So on behalf of the Royal and Indigenous Tourism Ontario, I'd like to thank Chef Tawnya Brant for having us today and cooking such a delicious dish.